And good evening. Thanks so much for being with us here on this edition of Healthline on PBS 39 HD. I'm your host, Mark Evans. Tonight, we're talking about valvular heart disease in our cardiac series. And our special guest is a returning guest, in fact. It's Dr. Dr. Robertson. He's a cardiologist and affiliated with the Parkview Phyisicians Group and also the medical director at Parkview Heart Institute. It's great having you here tonight.
Thank you for having me.
And we're going to learn a lot. I know there are a lot of people with some heart problems and this valvular heart disease. How long have we been actually really focusing on this? I mean, this is something in the last couple of decades, isn't it? Something like that?
Well, certainly we focus on anything more when we know we can advance the treatment.
Mm-hmm.
So when we know we can do more for people, we become more interested. And that's kind of a natural evolution of all illnesses. Valvular heart disease has been around since heart disease has been around, period.
Sure.
And is extremely common. It basically sisters in with all the common type of heart disease that people are familiar with. The number one adult reason to have valvular heart disease is coronary artery disease and a subsequent dysfunction of the heart, which then causes valves to behave abnormally.
Mm-hmm.
You look at other big groups like congenital heart disease, those people that are born with abnormalities of their valves, not allowing them to function well. Some people with unfortunate illnesses such as autoimmune diseases, lupus, and other things like that. Infectious agents sometimes can cause valvular heart disease. So there are different groups of problems that can cause valvular heart disease, all manifesting somewhat differently. And as time has gone on, we've become very, very good at picking up valvular heart disease.
Mm-hmm.
Our primary tool is echocardiogram, the ultrasound machine that we look at the valves with, and we can see the valve actually move. We can see and measure the velocities across valves to see how quickly and efficiently blood is moving across the valve and get a lot of information. We can move from there to MRI imaging, CT imaging, and some other special nuclear tests. So we have a lot of ways to look for it, and now we have more ways to treat it. So we're very, very interested in making everyone aware and being on top of their specific problems.
All right, and we want to field as many questions and concerns as possible tonight, so the phone number will be on the screen throughout the program. It'll be 969-2720 for the local calls and long distance toll free at 866-969-2720. So please call us. In the next half hour or so, we'll be intercepting those phone calls. And in the meantime, Dr. Robertson, if you don't mind, you brought some models, and we'd love to find out how the heart works. And we have four chambers I know we're dealing with and four valves.
Certainly.
Can you explain that?
Well, absolutely. This is a very simple model of the heart, but in fact, gives us some idea about the internal structure of the heart. And when we open this up, what we noticed is that there are two pumping chambers on the bottom of the heart, and in the top of the heart, two collecting chambers, and they're divided by two valvular structures.
Mm-hmm.
And so these valvular structures basically act as one-way doors to allow blood to move in a forward fashion throughout the cardiac cycle. Blood actually circulates in a figure-eight fashion, and if you follow basically the blood flow, the blood that would come into this chamber, which is the right atrium, is going to come from the body after it's circulated, needing oxygen, going into the right heart or the smaller of the two pumping chambers, and then up into the lungs here through the pulmonary artery. It then comes back around, oxygenated now, into the left atrium, which would be located up here, through the mitral valve, and then up through the aortic valve into the head, neck, and body to supply oxygenated blood. So what we look at as in regard to valvular disease is really this left side. The left-sided valves are the ones that we're really concerned about. The left side is really where the work's being done as far as distributing blood to the body, oxygenated blood. And the main workhorse valve, if you will, of the heart is the mitral valve. This mitral valve separates blood coming from the lungs into the pumping chamber and separates a tremendous pressure difference. The pressure here might be 10 millimeters of mercury. The pressure in this chamber may very well be 120, exactly what your blood pressure would be.
Wow.
So the difference here is 110 millimeters of mercury. So this little guy has a lot of work to do for a small tissue valve. And then the aortic valve, which is the main valve out the top of the heart going up to the head and neck, is a valve that separates the pumping chamber and that main aorta. And its pressure gradient is somewhat less, but still significant. So those are the two valves that we really look at when we think about people with heart disease and having to intervene. Mm-hmm. Now, the majority of people that have heart disease and have valvular disease, we can treat with medications, far and away the majority. The ones that we cannot, we have some special procedures that we can do.
Right.
Sometimes those are percutaneous. I mean going through a blood vessel with a catheter and feeding catheters up into the heart and actually manipulating the valve. We can actually clip this mitral valve. We can put a little clip on it to make it open and close a bit less if it leaks too much, for example. And in modern day, Dr. Doug Gray and myself are looking at a procedure to put in what we call percutaneous valves, which means that we either actually go up from the groin with a valve that's crimped on a balloon, or through the chest wall, through this part of the heart here, and then come up into the heart and actually place a new aortic valve right inside the heart as the heart's beating and functioning and the patient's circulating. Mm-hmm. That's much different than a surgical procedure in general when 90% of the time you have the sternum sawed open, your chest opened, the heart opened, then actually visualizing the heart, not exactly like this, but in some fashion to see the valve, extracting the valve and putting a new valve in.
Much less invasive then.
So it is less invasive,
okay,
yes.
Good. I'll tell you what, I want to get back to some of the surgical procedure. It's a fascinating subject tonight. We're talking about valvular heart disease. And on line one, we do have Sandy. And I think it is, of course, it's a question about the heart. So go ahead, Sandy. Thanks for calling and watching Healthline. Hello, Sandy.
Yes.
Go ahead with your question. Okay.
If you've had a stent and a couple weeks later you really start every morning, not throwing up, but morning sickness, like every morning, could that be from the stent?
Well, that's an excellent question. Of course, that gets back to coronary artery disease and the process of opening arteries. We use stents basically are metal structures which are used then to open the artery and allow more blood flow through that artery. I think the things that I would look at if someone was to be ill after a stent would be new medications maybe introduced at the time of the stent to help the stent perform. It's very unlikely that a patient would be truly allergic to a stent. Most of the stents are based on a stainless steel or a cobalt chromium type platform, fairly inert to the body. They are coated with what's called a polymer, a plastic substance which actually holds a drug and allows that drug to elute into the artery to allow scarring tissue from building up. Because you have to remember these arteries are about 3 millimeters in diameter, and the last thing we really want is a scar formation or reactive formation to that area to cause a narrowing and not allowing blood to go through for a new process that would be restenosis or rescarring.
Right.
So it's possible that you could have a little reaction to the medication. We do not see that very frequently. That's something we can usually treat with medications. My suspicion by hearing that would be, let's look and see what medicines were introduced around that time and see if we have anything that's changed substantially.
Mm-hmm. So she should definitely see her cardiologist.
Definitely.
About that.
Yes, okay. Definitely. Absolutely.
All right, Sandy, thank you so much. And we're going to encourage more phone calls. The number is on your screen, 969-2720 for the local calls and 866-969-2720 for those long distance calls toll free. Back to valvular heart disease and just doing some research and some reading before we did this show. I know there's at least a dozen types of heart valve diseases. What are the most common and what causes those?
Yeah, the most common, let's just break it down into say, okay, let's look at these left-sided heart valves and we'll take the aortic valve for example.
Okay.
Aortic valve can either be stenotic, meaning that it cannot open fully. In other words, it's thickened or calcified and can't open completely, not allowing enough blood to flow through. So what happens is the pressure head builds up in this pumping chamber, never can quite get through, and the circulation's less than optimal on the other side of the valve. Mm-hmm. Or it can be leaky, so it can just not able to hold the blood after it pumps it through. These valves basically act like a parachute almost. If you consider a parachute with its strings coming down to the individual on the parachute, what happens is the valves open and then the chordal structures, which you can see here, these little linear type structures which attach to the muscle themselves, actually just catch the valve and it acts like a parachute, just stopping it so that it opens and then closes on plane. Now when you look at the aortic valve, in children, the most common reason to have an aortic valve problem would be probably aortic valve stenosis, which would be a congenital problem. In other words, the valve, instead of having three pieces, much like this valve here, for example, if you can see this, much like this valve, demonstrated here, has three sections to it. Sometimes individuals can be actually born with two. That's called a bicuspid aortic valve. Yeah. And that may not function completely normally, or over time degenerate more quickly because it's not functionally as efficient as this particular valve. In elderly patients, the aortic valve dysfunction is most commonly associated with degenerative things. And one of the big issues is cholesterol and blood pressure. Those two factors, I think, really play a big role in how those valves behave over time. In other words, if your blood pressure is high, we always say, people are always thinking when we say, you have to watch your risk factors. They're always concerned about coronary disease, and that is a primary concern. But not only that, it affects all parts of your heart. High blood pressure pounding on these valves and these small, thin leaflets, which are almost paper thin when they're normal. The valves just can't stand that, and they don't like that. So what happens is they become stiffened and thickened, and then they may not open correctly, i.e. aortic stenosis. And then finally, things like Marfan syndrome and things like that, where people actually have tissue dysfunction. The actual tissues that start to expand and are not as firm and as leather-like as they should be. They become more rubbery and expandable. And what happens is the actual root this aortic valve sits in, it starts to expand and stretches that valve apart, and then it starts to leak. Mm. So those are kind of examples of why a mitral valve might not work. Now, aortic valve. The mitral valve itself typically doesn't work in association with the pumping chamber not working well. And it's very, very subject to dilatation or enlargement of the pumping chamber. When this pumping chamber starts to enlarge, say have a heart attack and part of it dies and it stretches the annulus or the circle around this valve, causing it then to become too large and the valve not to be able to close appropriately and have leakiness of that valve. Mm-hmm. That's one of the reasons that I brought this little interesting piece of equipment here, and this is a little piece of equipment that surgically can be implanted around that mitral valve to actually close it or to make it smaller, to make it more of a normal configuration. So that would allow a valve that wasn't working just because the annulus was too large to be brought back to a more normal size. We put that around there and squeeze that down. When you talk about all this, the one thing that does resonate to me for adult patients that are listening, and that is that risk factor modification is extremely important. Because if you were going to ask me really what number one thing do you think is going to affect most adults as far as valve disease over time, I would say it's the common risk factors. It's the blood pressure, it's sedentary lifestyle, it's the high cholesterol, it's those things that really impact all tissues in the body. But this is constantly moving. This is a machine that never quits. When it quits, then everything quits. Mm-hmm. So this motor really never stops. And so you can imagine, you have to take your car in every 5,000, 3,000 miles to have something done to it. This doesn't get that opportunity. So you got to take care of it.
Right. Very good points. We're going to get back to valvular heart disease in just a moment, but we have a call on line five. In fact, it's Jeremy who prefers to stay off the air, and that's quite all right. He says he's 40 years old. He's on both blood pressure and cholesterol medications. How likely is it to get off the meds with exercise and diet? And that's a wonderful question because I'm on both of those kinds of medications.
It's a wonderful question. And I think the first thing is to come to grips with the fact that there are certain things we can control, certain things we can't control. One of my favorite advertisements in television years ago was a cholesterol company that just basically showed an individual walking down a runway at a contest and falling down, and describing how basically it's showing how it wasn't really her fault. And there's some things that you just can't control. You have to come to grips if you have a problem. What is the right thing for me to do to take care of this problem? I think it's extremely ambitious and appropriate to say I'm going to lose weight, I'm going to stay active, and I'm going to eat the right food. But it isn't always anticipated that those things will lead to you not being able to be on medication, because the genetic factors sometimes that play a role do not allow us to really change how our bodies are responding to some of the environment in which we've grown up. Mm-hmm. American lifestyles over time have probably changed our genetics, probably changed our tendencies, just like the evolution of any other species on Earth over time. And so what we find is that some people could do that. They can get off their cholesterol medicine because their cholesterol drops. Some people can get off their blood pressure medicine because it drops. They lose 25 pounds and start to exercise every day. But I would stress that if, in fact, the blood pressure is high, If, in fact, the cholesterol is high, if, in fact, that leads to a risk factor profile, which down the line is going to put you at risk to have your heart filleted like this at one point in the middle of the afternoon by one of the surgeons, let's not do that. Let's just stay on something that's well-tolerated, not expensive, and move forward. And, you know, today, with generic pricing of medication, the easy accessibility of medications, the clean profile of a lot of medicines, meaning you can take a medicine that does what it's supposed to do, but it doesn't give you a headache and diarrhea and all these other things that the medications used to do. Mm-hmm. It's just important to think about all those things. You basically, I think, can get most good medications for blood pressure and cholesterol management now for no more than $4 a month. So there's expense really isn't is a concern.
And I've personally been told if I were to lose maybe 40, 50 pounds, I could probably get off the high blood pressure medication, but I'll probably always be on a statin. It's just a genetic thing. So
that's right.
I'm used to that, and I follow my doctor's orders, that's for sure. So basically, let's whittle this down. We were talking about some of the causes of valvular heart disease. Who is most at risk? Is it just elderly people, or?
Well, once you get beyond the congenital heart disease, those are the youngsters and the babies that have heart disease. Some infants can have extremely complex heart disease in which require multiple operations to allow their body to develop. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they're not even definitive operations until the end. In other words, we do two or three operations to get them to a certain age and a level of development such that they can have a more definitive operation, because their heart is growing and everything so quickly, you can't limit that part of it. Once you get into adulthood, the things, the people that are at risk are those people that have those risk factor profiles. And the way to know that is to go through processes of early detection and self-management. And that is, you know, like we just talked about, blood pressure. I think that the EBT scanner, for example, that we have at the Parkview Heart Institute, it's a wonderful tool. It's very low radiation, 5-minute test, and will screen your heart to see if there's any evidence of early premature coronary artery disease, allowing one to know, hey, I'm on this pathway, my cholesterol's not that bad, but I think I should talk to my doctor about the potential benefits of maybe being on a statin. How much does that reduce my risk over time? And it turns out, in fact, if you have coronary disease and take a statin, even having not had an event, your risks are markedly diminished over time. Mm-hmm. And it's the coronary artery disease and the destructive processes associated with hypertension, dyslipidemia, tobacco use, those kind of things that really put people at risk. So you ask me who's at risk? A lot of people are at risk, mm-hmm. and a lot of people have it. Fortunately, many people can skirt being markedly symptomatic from valvular disease with medications, and over time do fairly well. Some people have to have surgery. Acute valve problems, having a big heart, not paying attention, having a big heart attack, having a rupture of some of these chordal structures here on the side of the heart that I pointed out prior,
right,
can lead to acutely leaking and put patients into shock, and they can die within minutes. So a little bit of luck has to occur there. You have to be in the right place at the right time, standing and talking to the right people with the right tools to have your life saved. So it's just really important that people understand that a lot of people have this problem, a lot of people are at risk for this problem, and it can progress. So it's very important to stay on top.
So that's all so important in getting early detection of this, and it's very crucial.
That's correct.
Okay. All right, off subject for just a moment, because we're going to go to Dottie, who prefers to be off the air, but she's asking, do the benefits of being vegetarian outweigh the negative aspects that go along with eating red meat? Are there any problems with heart health that can arise from being a vegan?
Excellent question, because diet is really important.
Mm-hmm.
I will say, in kind of a summary statement, given our limited amount of time, that if I was going to tell somebody, if they asked me, what kind of diet should I go on to lose weight, I almost universally say Weight Watchers. And the reason I do that, if you look at Weight Watchers, they really place emphasis on portions and appropriate food groups.
Mm-hmm.
They don't really exclude any food groups, but they help you to understand the proportionality of your diet. And you know, we are built to eat meat, we're built to eat non-meat foods,
mm-hmm.
and a combination is fine. Certainly, there are meats, red meats that are good, okay. There are red meats that are obnoxious. And by obnoxious, I mean high in fat, soaked in butter, you know, et cetera, et cetera.
Mm-hmm.
You can use judgment for all those. I think that in regard to a vegetarian diet, unfortunately is not a problem-solving diet for the potential for heart disease. In other words, you could have a vegetarian diet, eat that entire life, and have blockage and end up with bypass surgery. Is that possible? Absolutely possible. Mm-hmm. The genetic components play a big role. Blood pressure plays a big role, all these other things. So unfortunately, I don't think there's a magic bullet there. It is important to reduce the amount of fat that you eat, et cetera. And those kind of things are something that we want to think about. But you know, you see a lot of high success in quick weight loss with high-protein diets, high-protein, high-fat diets, okay, Atkins diet. Mm-hmm. The problem is that's not a sustainable diet. It's tough on the kidneys, a little bit tough on the liver. There are some other adverse things about that. So it's not really cohesive for us for a long term. What we really want to do is change and modify our lifestyle, not one activity during the day. We can't skip a hamburger and say, I've really done my deal today. Mm-hmm. What you have to do is you have to modify your lifestyle so that all your dietary habits coincide with health.
All right, very good. We're going to go to line one in just a moment because Rose has a question about congestive heart failure, but I don't want to wrap up this program without finding out about the valves, the replacement valves.
Yes.
When folks, the medication, the prescriptions don't help and they have to go through the surgery and the replacement, what are those valves made of?
Well, there's a variety. There are two different varieties of valves, really simply put. The first one is, I think, demonstrated by this valve that I've brought here today, and this is just a model of a prosthetic valve. It's a tissue valve.
Okay.
So it is a metal structure around, or struts, that hold this tissue up. It has a sewing ring around there that actually is used to sew the valve in. And then it has the tissue over it. That tissue itself can be made from porcine or pig. It can be made from bovine or cow material, and it can also be made from human pericardium. So the sac around the heart, those kind of tissues are all used for bioprosthetic valves. We call it a bioprosthetic because it's a biologic tissue.
Okay.
Okay. The thing about these valves is that they're nice because, number one, you typically don't need anticoagulation or blood thinners after you have a valve such as this. Mm-hmm. The risk of infection afterwards over the years is just a little less than those that are more mechanical. The downside, in a sense, is that they don't last as long.
I was going to ask, what is the...
In a younger person, we have to think twice about, you know, the pluses and minuses of putting in a bioprosthetic valve. If the valve is going to last 6 to 12 years, 8 to 12 years, and then have to require another replacement, is that something that you want to do because you want to avoid anticoagulation because the youngster wants to mountain
right.
climb and that kind of thing.
So timing and age really have
exactly.
a lot to do with this.
And the other type of valve is a mechanical valve. This is just one example of a mechanical valve showing basically how the two leaflets open and close, made of carbon type materials. Similarly, these obviously don't have any tissue associated with them at all. They're almost foolproof as far as lasting. The majority of these valves last a lifetime once they're put in. They commonly do require anticoagulation or blood thinner for the most part, and all of those type of valves. So that's kind of a general picture of how we differentiate the two types of valves, you know, kind of what we think about when we put those in.
Okay. Now, we have two calls lined up, and if we don't get them live on the program, we want them to stay on hold because we will take care of those concerns for you off the air after the show. But let's go with Rose first. Rose, your question, please. Go ahead.
Yes, thank you for taking my call.
You bet.
I want to ask you, Dr. Robertson, I was diagnosed with... she called it first stage congestive heart failure, and that was in the spring of this year. And also, when they did a EKG, it was abnormal, so I had to have electrocardiogram.
Mm-hmm.
And that was pronounced that I had aortic valve dysfunction. It's not pumping properly. So I want to know, there's a test NT-5 or PROBNP, and that was for 424. Is that pretty high?
Pro-BNP, okay?
Okay, so we have about 30 seconds,
okay.
Doctor.
So what she's asking is, what she's stating is, I have an element of heart failure, i.e. blood not getting through the pumping chamber efficiently enough to maintain metabolic processes at a low level, grade one or stage one heart failure is what she was talking about, mm-hmm. which usually managed medically, related to leakiness of this aortic valve, which looks like this prosthetic valve here, and that is one of those things that we can treat with medications, and we just have to just watch real closely.
Okay. Dr. Roy Robertson, a cardiologist and affiliated with Parkview Physicians Group and medical director at the Parkview Heart Institute, thank you once again for being here tonight.
My pleasure.
Very interesting show. And we'd like for Mary and Rose to hang on the line. We'll take care of you in just a moment off the air. But next week, 7:30, here at the same station, PBS 39 HD, we'll discuss eye concerns with the very colorful Dr. Rex Parent. That's next week here on Healthline. In the meantime, take care of yourself. I'm Mark Evans. Good night.